So on behalf of myself and my co-organizer for this session, Clara Nustedt, welcome to this discussion on computing and the physical world. So the idea is to, in this morning session, is to explore how it is that computers interact with the world around us and how they affect our decisions and how they affect the world directly. And in doing that, we organized the session, and if I could get the agenda up, do I do that from here? I guess I do. There we go. Agenda day one. In doing that, we've organized this morning into roughly two topics that are not coincidentally reminiscent of things you've seen coming out of NSF and other government agencies. And the first topic we'll talk about is the way in which computers impact our urban environments. And so this is aligned with the sort of smart cities ideas. And we'll have a panel session on that with three speakers in that panel. And then the second part of the morning, we'll discuss how computers interact with the natural world and how they help shape our understanding of that world and affect the way in which we manage and sustain our natural environment. And so so with that, let me go ahead and introduce our first speaker, our keynote speaker for this morning, and that is Carla Gomes. And Carla Gomes is a professor of computer science at Cornell University. Her research has covered several themes in artificial intelligence and computer science, from the integration of constraint reasoning and machine learning for solving optimization problems. And recently, Carla has become involved in the establishment of a field called computational sustainability. And she is the director of the Institute for Computational Sustainability at Cornell University. And she has been the PI on an NSF expedition grant in computing that basically established this field of computational sustainability. And she currently leads another NSF expedition in the development of something called CompSusNet, which presumably she'll talk some about. Carla is a fellow of the Association for the Advancement of Artificial Intelligence, and she's a fellow for the American Association of the Advancement of Science. And so with that, let's go ahead and welcome Carla to the podium. And where is she? There she is. Okay, good.
Thank you so much, first, for inviting me to be here, for organizing this amazing meeting. Thanks, Russ, for the beautiful introduction. And I'm going to start this talk by thanking NSF for supporting this research. So as Russ mentioned, back in 2008, we received an expedition in computing award, and this expedition really allowed us to put forward a big vision for this new field, computational sustainability, and nucleate the field and identify core research areas for maximal impact, both in terms of computer science and sustainability. So, but you know, we can't really, this is a new area for computer science. It is a highly interdisciplinary area. So in order to ensure the sustainability of the field, we applied for a new NSF expedition, and we were awarded this expedition. So this is very exciting because, you know, this is an area that it's new for computer science. There's not much funding. So for us to grow this field, we really appreciate the support of NSF. That is really, okay. So what is computational sustainability? computational sustainability in terms of the big picture is really how we can inject computational methods for sustainable development. So in order to understand the notion of sustainable development, let me take you a few years back when the So in 1987, the United Nations Commission led by Brundtland called we refer to this as the Brundtland Commission, raised concerns for the first time about the sustainability and the state of our planet. They also introduced a very revolutionary notion that was the notion of sustainability and sustainable development. So sustainability and sustainable development is development that meets the needs of our present without compromising the needs of future generations. So this was an important notion, but more important, the Brundtland Commission emphasized that sustainability is not only about the environment. In fact, it encompasses balancing environmental, economic, and societal needs. And in fact, sustainability is really the ultimate goal of sustainable development is human well-being of current and future generations. So, because of the interconnectedness of the different factors, economic, social, and environmental factors, we are dealing with very complex systems with problems of unique scale and complexity. We are trying to manage in these systems. In order to manage these systems, we have to collect lots of data, different temporal and spatial scales. We are dealing with systems that are highly uncertain, and typically we have very complex nonlinear dynamics and also a multitude of agents with different preferences. So we have several computational challenges and a key challenge is really how we can put together and establish these large-scale interdisciplinary programs and collaborations. That's why we propose this network. This is a large network involving 12 academic institutions. We also have several NGOs and Gulf collaborators. And in order for us to really connect to the sustainability domains, we are partnering with a variety with several institutions, NGOs, and Gov institutions that provide us really the sustainability knowledge. For example, the Nature Conservancy, the Secretary of Environment in Ecuador, the USGS, ILRI, the International Livestock Research Institute in Kenya, the Trans-African Hydrometeorological Observatory, and other organizations. So our themes, in terms of computational sustainability themes, we are addressing questions in biodiversity and conservation, in balancing environment and socioeconomic needs, and energy and renewable resources. From a computational point of view, our key themes are big data and machine learning, optimization and dynamical models, and multi-agent systems and citizen science. So you will see we actually have a very wide range of applications across different sustainability domains, and this is actually by design because, after all, we are computer science, and this is actually a key message that I have emphasized through this process. If we want to get computer science engaged, we really need to look at cross-cutting core computational problems across these different domains. And I will emphasize this in this presentation. So I'm going to give you a sample of computational sustainability interdisciplinary research projects, then highlight these cross-cutting computational themes, and I'll talk about community building, and I'll wrap up with conclusions. So this clicker is super sensitive. So let me start with the area of biodiversity. And a key question when it comes to biodiversity is to know where species are, how species are distributed across landscapes and over time. So in order to understand species, we need to collect lots of data. We need to monitor them, and therefore we need a variety of sensors. We need, for example, we use satellite data. Landsat is an amazing, provides incredible environmental data. We use color data from, for example, in Africa, we have color data for tracking migratory, the migrations of herders. We use sound recorders for detecting flight calls or elephant calls. We use a variety of sensors, and there are many, many computational challenges in terms of how to collect the data, in terms of how to integrate the data. Typically, we need to bring together data from a variety of sources with different temporal scales and spatial scales, and how to interpret the data, because we basically get the raw signal, and for example, if we have recordings, we want to separate the different elephant calls or flight calls. There's also another very special sensor, the human sensor, and citizen science plays an amazing role in terms of sustainability. In fact, given the nature, given that often we are talking about phenomena and common pool resources, we really need to rely on citizen science to collect the data. eBird is a citizen science program of the Cornell Lab of Fall, and it is an amazing way for us to actually gather scientific knowledge, especially at a very large scale, and you will see that. It is a way for us to get information about birds that will allow us to make decisions for conservation, and it's also a way of increasing scientific literacy. So this citizen science program basically allows anybody interested in birds to submit data. And in fact, eBird has over 300,000 volunteer birders who have contributed with over 300 million bird observations, corresponding to more than 22 million hours of field work. That is quite remarkable. We collect this data and combine this data with environmental data, and using adaptive spatial temporal machine learning models and algorithms, we are able to correlate the environmental predictors to the patterns of occurrence and absence of the species. So here you see an animation that is really the output of the machine learning methods that shows the patterns of occurrence of the barn swallow for different months of the year. So this is actually important, because these models, in the end, they really give us the habitat preferences of the species. We, in fact, we have produced the help produce the state of the emergency report that is officially released by the Secretary of Interior with a variety, with these models for several species. Well, with this data, we can now think of fundamentally new ways of doing conservation. For example, the Nature Conservancy is using these models to protect migratory water birds in California against drought by paying farmers to keep water in the rice fields during the bird migration. So basically, farmers submit the bids. So the eBird models allow us to identify the Pacific flyway and the areas that need to be targeted. And then the farmers submit bids to keep the rice fields flooded during the migration. So with this fundamentally new way of approaching the problem, using big data, machine learning, and these market-based approaches, the Nature Conservancy has generated over 20,000 acres of additional habitat for water birds in California. So again, I want to stress that this is only possible because now we are using these advanced computational techniques for high-precision models. Let me point out that there are some challenges with citizen science. And one of the challenges, as you can see here, the data bias problem. Obviously, because citizen science volunteer their time, we cannot really be demanding. And in terms of, you know, how, where, and when they should send the submissions. But as a result, we have this data bias problem. The submissions coincide mainly with the urban areas. So we are using game theoretic approaches to try to reduce these data bias. And here I show a principal agent framework, and the idea is we place incentives we place incentives in areas that are undersampled. We know that the citizen science see the incentives, we know their behavior, so we place the incentives in such a way that we are going to induce a more uniform distribution. It has been quite incredible because in our first pilot project, we were able to actually spread the distributions considerably. In fact, we were able to shift about 20% to undersampled locations. We are also starting a major initiative with Ecuador, and here the idea is to actually develop corridors for the Andean bear. But you know, a major challenge when it comes to protecting biodiversity is often we need to really take into consideration the communities that depend on the forest. For example, here, this is a very, the Ecuador is a hot biodiversity spot. And if for us to protect the forest, we can protect the forest, but we need to really make sure that we are also improving the lives of the local communities. So there are many challenges in terms of bringing together these environmental issues with socioeconomic factors. So I now want to talk about other projects. For example, contrary to the US, where we have lots of environmental data, Africa, the situation is quite different. Africa is very poorly sensed. They have very poor maps in terms of weather, vegetation, etc. And so we are now starting efforts to try to improve that situation. And in particular, for example, I'm highlighting here a project led by Tom Dietrich, and the idea is to deploy a large number of low-cost weather stations in Africa in order to improve the weather maps. This is important, for example, for crop insurance, because if we don't have good weather data, insurance are not willing insurance companies are not willing to insure the farmers. We also have another initiative that is very similar to eBird, but in Africa, where herders submit images and surveys of vegetation. So we this is actually part of the larger program where we have we are working with the social scientists, and they have this index-based insurance. And the idea is, rather than waiting to see the cattle die, the insurance agree that when the index of the NDVI shows that the season was very dry, they automatically make payments. The problem is this index of vegetation is an index of greenness, but not an index of palatability. So we are trying to improve the models to get better data and improve this index-based insurance. We also have projects, this is led by Princeton and CMU, on energy storage and economic dispatch in the presence of renewables. Again, we are dealing with highly uncertainty environments, and in order when it comes to renewables, they are non-dispatchable, and in order to plan the smart grid in the presence of renewables, we really need to model uncertainty and develop robust plans. Again, dealing with multiple scales, multiple time scales and temporal scales. So, I thought now I would spend a little more time talking about a new area for computer science that I believe it is very exciting, very promising, and I actually think we can have tremendous impact in terms of helping accelerate material discovery for new materials. So, in 2010, there was a report by the DOD, and the report stated that existing energy approaches will not be enough to secure our energy future. Meeting the challenge will require scientific breakthroughs in new materials. So we are working with Caltech, with the Joint Center for Artificial Photosynthesis, and our goal is to accelerate the development of solar fuels generators. How am I doing in time? So basically, if we can really accelerate the development of solar fuel cells, that will have tremendous impact, because solar fuels can be substantially produced and stored. And we can produce solar fuels by combining, carbon dioxide and water. So let me give you a very high-level perspective on how this process goes. So material science have devised ways of synthesizing thousands of materials. And you see there an apparatus where there are three guns, they sputter metals, and this is similar to atomic spray painting. So once they synthesize these materials, now they need to characterize them. In order to characterize them, they use different methods, for example, X-ray diffraction, and you see actually my student using the Cornell high-energy synchrotron. So what is the key challenge? The key challenge is that we would like to infer, based on the X-ray diffraction patterns, we would like to infer the crystal structure of materials. So this is a very challenging problem. What you see here is there a pointer? Basically, you see the different dots. The different dots correspond to different samples, different X-ray diffraction patterns, and you see the diffraction patterns stacked. So the problem that we are trying to solve is, based on the diffraction patterns, I would like to infer the crystal structure, the different crystals structures, for example, an FCC crystal structure or other crystal structures of the materials. Well, very good, thank you. So you see here we have different crystal structures. Why is this problem difficult? Well, this problem is difficult because the X-ray diffraction patterns are mixed, and it is challenging to unmix them. So I'm not going to go over details, but this problem is defined. You know, you can think of this problem for the computer science as a clustering problem, where I want to identify the different little clusters that correspond to different crystal structures. But, you know, the reality is that the state-of-the-art of machine learning methods really cannot solve this problem. And we are using a combination of techniques to approach this problem, using, you know, machine learning techniques. But as I said, machine learning techniques fail to capture the underlying physics of the materials. And because of that, we also use techniques from constraint reasoning and optimization and probabilistic reasoning. And in fact, I see Moshe is here. We encode the theory of this problem as a SAT module theory. And we actually made some progress, and we can solve some instances, but still it takes about 15 hours to find solutions, which is considerable progress given that right now material science really solved this problem mainly manually. So one key question that we had was, can we actually use citizen science and crowdsourcing and human computation to help solve this problem? And here I show a general framework where, in order to solve this problem, and remember, we want to solve this problem and have the layperson help us solve this problem, we need to really decompose this problem into a way that a child can understand it. So what do we do? Well, basically, here I have a representation of, again, the different samples we get. This is, for example, this point. Here I have the spectrogram of the X-ray diffraction pattern. We also produce a heat map of the pattern. You know, the darker the color or the greener, the higher the intensity of the beam. And then, for example, for this slice, we stack them, and basically you see that there are some interesting patterns there. And what we do is we now crowdsource these patterns, but we really don't even talk about material science. We basically ask people to look at these patterns, and we give a little tutorial, and basically we say, well, we want to find, you know, blobs that are together. And you see how we marked, or they marked, these little three blobs that exhibit similar behavior. So we explain what we mean by similar behavior, and we were amazed how, you know, we get really good feedback from the Mechanical Turkers or high school students taking the summer course at Cornell. And in fact, basically, based on we collect this vast amount of data, we use algorithms to aggregate and make sure that the input is consistent, and then we select the most promising candidate solutions, and we pass to a solver. And basically, we have a solver, and the idea is, and that was our conjecture, and this goes back to some other work, that, you know, the humans are able to identify key patterns that are what we call like backdoors to the solvers. If I find these key patterns, then I can solve the problem almost by propagation. And that is exactly what we observed. We observed that for example, for this particular system, this aluminum, lithium, iron system, where a solver takes about 15 hours with minimal input from the users, we could go down to about 13 hours to 1,000 seconds. So that was quite remarkable. You know, I have to say, this is synthetic data. So the system is very realistic, but still is synthetic data. So it is a more challenge when we have the real instance because of the noise. Still, I'm going to show you some interesting results. This is a real system, and in fact, very noisy data. And this is a system, palladium, tantalum, and rhodium. And you will see why humans are so good at solving this problem. So here is a very interesting slice. And what the computer or the algorithms get lost because they are trying to explain these peaks. But if you look at this, I mean, this is really noise. We can dismiss this, and in fact, you know, the users were able to nicely, and this is not a difficult question, a difficult task for humans, to aggregate all these slices, all these peaks as together, and that actually gives us the information that they are peaks from the same face. And so this was quite remarkable, and in fact, we could now solve this system. And this hybrid human machine solution is way better than just the humans or only the machine. And in fact, our collaborators were able to find a platinum-free catalyst for methanol oxidation based on a better characterization of the phases for the system. So this is quite exciting and promising, and I really believe this is an area where computer science can have tremendous impact. I'm going to final, my last example is quite different, and again, this I saw motion. This is an example. You will understand why I'm mentioning this. But basically, I actually often use these examples and tell my students how important it is for us to think abstractly, or, you know, to try to find, you know, general methodologies to tackle problems. So basically, for when it comes to agriculture and fertilizers, you know, fertilizers have revolutionized the world. And in fact, they have allowed us to increase production dramatically. But nitrogen-based fertilizers are also major culprits in terms of the production of greenhouse gas emissions. So a while back, I started working with Harold Varness. I'm very proud to say that I have it's called extension publications. Cornell has this land grant mission, and I start working on with Harold on designing protocols for experimenting fertilizers. This is an interesting problem. Just to keep things in perspective, the average annual nitrous oxide losses per acre is 7.5 pounds. And if we assume, for example, we have 5 acres of corn, the annual global warming impact is equivalent to about 1.8 million miles of driving. So it is important to use the right amount of fertilizers, and therefore Harold Varness, my colleague, asked me to work on designing experiments for the fertilizers. This is basically what they do. They use these Latin squares. Here you see a Latin square. If you've played Sudoku, a Sudoku is a Latin square. But for agronomic experiments, you need a balanced Latin square. And they wanted up to 35 treatments, meaning a 35 by 35 square. At the time, I thought, oh, no problem. But because they want, you know, basically balanced Latin squares, which means that all the pairs of treatments are subject to the same conditions, it turns out that this problem actually is very difficult, and we couldn't solve instance for order larger than 6. We were shocked, and this was quite shocking because, you know, I had actually worked on this problem. I thought it would be trivial, but it turns out these constraints make the problem very hard. So we actually looked at this problem, and in order to solve it, and this is the thing. Here we really, when we have problems, we need to solve them. We cannot really avoid them. But looking at solutions for small instances, here for order 6, we realized there was a lot of structure, lots of properties. Some solutions were symmetric, etc. So we were able to, by identifying this structure, generate larger and larger instances, and in fact, we were able to produce Latin squares for up to order 40. And when it came to, you know, write a paper about this, at the time I was working with Meinhof Selman, a postdoc, and he wrote about how we had solved this fertilizer problem. And I said, well, we really should, you know, see the big picture and then think about what we actually did, the process. And basically, that's what led us to this notion of streamlined constraint reasoning. And the idea is, in order to solve a problem, we are going to impose constraints to partition the solution space into smaller parts. Basically, we are trying to solve a problem of finding spatially balanced Latin squares, and we now want to say, I want spatially balanced squares that they are also symmetric. And by adding properties, we are narrowing the search space for the algorithm. And by doing this, we could actually generate very large solutions. But the next thing then we asked was, well, can we actually solve this problem independently without thinking of the particular domain that we are considering? And that's when we thought about this idea of parity constraints and XR streamlining, where the idea is I'm going to impose what we call parity constraints that are going to divide my search space automatically in half, and now I'm going to search this new space. Well, so this actually led us to this XR streamlining, and this led us to very exciting techniques for counting, sampling, and inference that, you know, several students, including my student Stefan Ehrman, did very exciting work on this parity-based counting, sampling, and inference techniques. And this all started with the fertilizer problem. I always mention this to my students that whenever we solve a problem, we really need to look at the big picture. And in fact, we need to always, and I make a point of, you know, see how our approaches can be applied to other problems and be generalized. Because, you know, that is the exciting part about computer science, is to really find these cross-cutting approaches to solve large classes of problems. And so let me just, interestingly, you know, this problem, I conjecture that this problem actually would have an easy polynomial time construction, but we couldn't find it. Well, actually, again, recently, or 2 years ago, my student Ronan Urbraz, pushing again this streamlined constraint reasoning and human computation techniques, he was able to find actually a construction for producing these spatially balanced Lattice squares for particular orders when the order 2n plus 1 is prime. So, but you know, this is very exciting, but it is a good example of computational thinking where, you know, if we tackle a problem and then look back and understand how we formulate and how we can abstract it out, we can really produce very exciting methodologies for a variety of problems. So we are actually working with Harold on this system for nitrogen management. And again, the idea here is to bring together, you know, data and develop methodology that will allow us to deliver the right amount of nitrogen without using it in excess. So I want to wrap up now by going back to this big picture and emphasizing the fact that as computer scientists, for the sustainability of computer science in computational sustainability, we really need to have a computer science approach, and indeed we need to understand the cross-cutting computational themes that we study. So I mentioned a variety of sustainability domains. I mentioned some examples. And again, a key point that I'm emphasizing here is I do believe that if we want to build a cohesive agenda from a computer science perspective, we really need to go deep in terms of the different problems we study, and we need to identify these cross-cutting core computational problems and apply them to different sustainability areas. To illustrate this point, I mentioned high-throughput material structure identification, and I mentioned en passant another problem that we are working on. That is the problem of flight call detection, of elephant call detection. So here is the elephant listening project is a project where they record, this is also actually led also by the lava foe. They record, they have recorders in the forest, and basically they want to identify when there is an elephant call. Well, what is interesting is these two problems seem quite different, yet computationally speaking, they share a lot in common. They are actually what we call source separation problems, where we have a signal and we want to decompose the signal into its components. It's a signal X-ray diffraction patterns. We want to decompose into the different crystal structures, or the recordings we want to decompose into the different sounds, if it is an elephant or a cricket or a plane, etc. So my philosophy is, as computer science, we really need to study these problems together. And in fact, students solving one problem, studying one problem, are also studying, working on both problems. Another example is, I talked about this AV caching, where we are trying to incentivize citizens to visit the undersampled areas. This problem, we use mechanism design. Colleagues at USC are using the same approach, the same principal agent game theory model, to decide where to place patrols to prevent poaching and illegal fishing. So these problems, computationally speaking, are, you know, very similar. And in fact, now here we see these subway lines where we have a variety of sustainability applications where the common lines are computational themes. This is, again, important because, as computer science, we develop methodologies that are going to be applied to a variety of themes. So let me conclude. As I mentioned before, the first expedition in computational sustainability was very productive. We produced a variety of papers in computer science, but also other disciplines. We organized a variety of meetings to nucleate the field of computational sustainability. And we also placed several students at tenure track assistant positions. And it has been quite exciting. We were able to identify core research directions in terms of CS and in terms of sustainability. But I have to emphasize that a key challenge is really how to navigate and get involved in this highly interdisciplinary area. It is very refreshing and exciting to see a growing number of computer science who are interested in getting involved in computational sustainability research, but really they don't have the connections and access to these projects and the community. So these meetings are really, really important to really create this community. We also, because of that, we propose this large network where we have research activities, but also community building activities, education and outreach. And we organize several also meetings. We have we have organized several meetings and conferences and special tracks at conference, which is actually very important to grow the community. We are planning to have a journal on computation sustainability soon, and actually we also are organizing our conference. In July. So let me now summarize. Basically, computational sustainability, I see this as a two-way street. On one hand, we believe that we can inject computational thinking into sustainability science that will provide new insights, methodologies, and solutions to sustainability problems with societal impact. But on the other hand, we also believe that sustainability questions or the sustainability domains will lead to new challenging problems for computer science that will also import new formalisms and concepts from other disciplines that will lead to new core paradigmatic problems and in computer science. Therefore, it will also help the field develop. And of course, it will this area will broaden the scope of CS and the diversity of CS. So, to summarize, I believe this area will have high potential to advance the state of the art of computer science, driven by concrete sustainability challenge. Thank you.
I mean, you've given us a beautiful example of how computational thinking can be relevant to an important area such as sustainability. At the same time, I think that we could probably find many other areas in which computational thinking will have such impact. Computational archaeology, I mean, it's an active field. And I'm wondering, what does the computer science department of the future look like? Do they have the hallway of the computational archaeologists and the sustainabilists and the biologist? Are we just becoming a discipline whose job is to embed ourselves in other areas? And I'm trying to think of what are your thoughts on what does the future of computer science looks like from this point of view?
So the question is, what I believe the future of computer science will look like, and if we'll have different areas and we'll be specializing to different aspects. So that's a very good question, and I do think that, you know, computer science is permeating all the fields, and to some extent, you know, sustainability or the area of sustainability, as you saw in my talk, covers different areas. You know, we talk about you know, impact in terms of biodiversity, in terms of the, you know, socioeconomic and ecological corridors for wildlife. So, and what I think the approach, and I thought about that a lot, is, and I try to emphasize that aspect in the talk, is that as computer scientists, we should really look at these cross-cutting computational problems and then apply them to different areas. So that was my key message with the subway line. The subway line shows that even though we are tackling a variety of problems, in the end, you know, there are these common themes in computer science that will bring us together. And I think that is actually important. I mean, there are different options. You know, I've had several students who actually decided to go and, you know, really go and work for an NGO, or, you know, do bird conservation. That is an option. But I also have, I think another option is, as computer science, we develop these methodologies, and we then can apply our methodologies to different domains. You know, we have several reoccurring themes, and I think that's how, you know, the computer science field will grow, is by using, you know, deep learning across a variety of domains. So, I'm not sure if that answers your question.
It's the beginning of an answer. Thank you.